Todo mundo presente, sou da Vigência de Oduardo, sou Pedro Sardini e eu continuo a dizer afternoon chairman, ok? Ok, vou.
Just like any talks have.
The teller and the overseas. land regulation was done, we operated a farmer that is the second person in the list. Because we wanted to emphasize to the farmers that apart from the fencing value of the plants, we can use it for something else. And since we know name, which has been emphasized to the farmers, and we ask the farmer which extraction method, the law, of course, is to grind the seeds and then mechanically squeeze out the oil, which they did. We planted two seeds, three plants, and then packed it into one. Only was done as normal. We had better application of fertilizer. Then, data collection. We tried to look at the vine depth and look at the population of the plants of all the. How do these treatments, Jatropha, Neem, Silo Lambda, Silo Hadrin, up and compare to the non-application, which was the control? As you see, one, we used a hand lens, which was comfortable to the farmer being operated. Hand lens, we were able to pick every step. As a board of power picked, we picked an every. And was very harvesting, we collected the pods, took weight of the pods, look at the pod length, and analysis was done using ANOVA and separated with the new Duncan multiple range test. Results. You can see that when looking at the different concentrations, you see where air is, there's no significant difference between Jatropha and the what we call it, the Neem, as I directed. However, Lambda was as equal in performance was observed at 30% Jatropha gave more significantly higher values than other treatments. Effects of different concentrations and Lambda on total grain yield of cowpea. We see 3% and Lambda, no significant difference. And these two significantly outyield 3% of azadirachtin. Discussion. Actually, azadirachtin has been overstrayed. Is commercialized. Jatropha is almost a known oil, and it is a desirable property. We are just trying to get into it. It is so great, it contains the football. When we tried it in the lab, we have left a different fungal toxicity was high. Was high, And now in the field, we've seen that that Jofa oil can be used as an insecticidal biopesticide to control aphids. Aphids, rather, may be spoken because it's difficult to work with. They are so naive. And when they attack a plant, all you expect is the colors, the virus it could have transmitted as a vector, as we know it is to Empresiphora to be on cowpeas. From the experiment, we observed that cowpea grain was obtained from plants treated with 3% of Jatropha caucus. This study, if a nest would not have one pesticide, would keep us in clue, at least to our farmers. See, farmers in Nigeria, since the government may be interested, but they are not practically working with the farmers. It's difficult to get these farmers to be interested in the use of our pesticides. But we in the university, we try to get the local farmers, because in our research farms, we have a section for local farmers, more or less a model farm, and we compare that to their own local farms, which is just adjacent to our research farms. Conclusion and recommendation. The research showed that seed extract of Jatropha caucus and indica were able to control the Empresiphora on cowpea fields. The increase in the concentration of the oil extract resulted in a corresponding increase in the yield of cowpeas. The sense concentration resulting in the highest yield. Jatropha oil was found to be relatively more effective and can compare favorably with lambda cyhalothrin. But since lambda cyhalothrin is a synthetic, and we are trying to phase out this synthetic pesticide with our attainment problems, we can increase research on some of these oil pesticides. Like Jatropha. We have a lot of Jatropha growing in Nigeria, especially the southern parts. They are using it just to fence their compound. That's all. And the trees are there as yet. So if we can harness research and then walk these plants into our research, we will actually go a way to replace most of the synthetic we have, since this ability is only utilization that is our problem. Thank you.
Thank you very much for this nice presentation. We have time for questions.
Well, I don't know, there has been presentations here on the Jatropha caucus as a pesticide containing forests. My previous studies at Heidelberg University, Germany, indicate that forests are highly pro-carcinogenic. Are we going to use these extracts or continue to use these extracts while we know they are in the category of causing cancer to humans?
The presentation indicates how the Jatropha got in contact with the human being, or how the human being got in contact with Jatropha. Was it just application, or was it other? Indication that Because what we do is we try to protect ourselves, protect the farmers, using laws. The farmer found the seeds and laws. We don't allow it to come in contact with the asking. So I don't know at what stage. We don't drink it. We try to avoid those fungus, except when we use drugs. And that is one of the protective ways we can avoid chemicals. Is it through inhalation?
We have one more question.
Sorry. This is maybe just a attempt to maybe clarify that question. The profile, when you use it in treatments of this produce, you don't use the product, you don't consume it. They are literally used as planting materials, considering the toxic nature of this plant. When once it is used, it is advised that you don't consume the plant, but rather use the plant or the material you've treated as planting materials. Thank you.
Now we are moving to the next speaker, Okendo. Yeah. Okay, who's going to talk about the bioefficacy of selected plant extracts against two spider mites, the Granicus urticae in 20 years?
Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. I hope you enjoyed your lunch. It was a deep design for you to join now. Now, I want to take you through one of the researches that was done and was supported by the Forum Foundation, Forum, and this was for the graduate students' research program. We picked on two common plants which are native to Kenya and we felt could be used for purposes of solving farmers' problems in French beans. Now, as a way of introduction, for those who have not been to Kenya, that is the map of Kenya, I'm not linked to Africa, but we reside in East Africa. We talk about French beans and how the two-spotted spider mite is a problem in French beans. Now for Kenya, currently agriculture-related sectors contribute about 52% of the GDP and employs the bulk of people in Kenya. Now, there are four main subsectors. Mainly, we have industrial crops, food crops, horticulture and livestock, and fisheries. Now, production, generally, whether it is for livestock or crops, is affected by the seasons and vagaries of weather. Now, French bean in Kenya is grown mainly for the fresh vegetable exports, which constitutes 48% of the exports. Now, the production of this crop is mainly constrained by both abiotic and biotic factors. But for this study, we focused on one of the biotic factors that is actually constraining the production of French beans, which is the two-spotted spider mite. So I have a photo of what to expect when your trade field is heavily invested with the spider net. Now, most farmers use a synthetic weedicide or herbicide, which over time are known to be expensive and also have toxicity to target organisms, including man. And more importantly, the synthetic chemicals are also known to have those chemical residues which have issues when it comes to export commodities. Now, the question we ask ourselves, are botanicals a viable alternative to the synthetics in this world? The work that I'm going to present revolves around three objectives. That is looking at the mitified cellular efficacy of two plants, that is Osimum pratissimum and Leonotis, the petifolia extract against the mite. Then also look at the possibility if extracts could have productive inhibition and repellent effects. And then finally, if the application has the relevance to the farmer by improving the yield of the trade union. Now, I'll put there the photos of the two plants, that is Osimum and the Leonotis, and the famous two-spotted spider mite. Now, the two plants that were used for this work were collected around the university, that is where we see in Nakuru, in Kenya. The first one, which was Osimum, was collected about 35 kilometers from the university, but the Leonotis were collected very close to the university because you can easily find it as you drive along the highways. Now, basically, composite fresh samples, that is for leaves and the sample stems, were collected, shed dry for 2 weeks, then were put in an oven for 48 hours so that we could get constant weight. Thereafter, the dry materials were ground using an electric hammer mill in fine powder that was actually used to prepare the formulation, which was in percent weight by volume. And the material was finally prepared and put into 5 concentrations that I'll show you. Now, the inoculum for the two-spotted spider mite was obtained from infested red bean leaves. And the mites were reared on young plants, which are 2 to 3 weeks old. So we had experiments of contact toxicity, was wanted to see whether preparations which methanolic extracts of the same could have toxic effects and therefore could be used for direct control. We also ran composition inhibition experiments, and here we are using adult females to see how much in terms of reduction, egg laying reduction would be done for the 2 different extracts. Then we also ran the balance test for the adult insects, but these were not sexed insects. The fourth experiment was on field assay, but in plots where which were covered by nylon mesh, so that we don't allow, after introducing the mice, you don't allow any additional from outside the treated. Then we collected data for each of the work that was done, and the data that we had on population, yield and yield components, we ran data analysis appropriately, and where there was need for transformations to homogenize the data before analysis of variants, what we did, and then we used to this HSD test for purposes of mean separation. Now, with respect to efficacy, we realized that there was a very clear dose and plant-dependent response against adult insects, and it came out that the mortality for both of them peaked at 3% weight by volume and a half, superior to the synthetic methicillamine was used as a control in this particular experiment. So what I've presented here is like the end point for each of the two plants, that is for the methicillamine effect. Now, for the oviposition inhibition, at the highest concentration that was tested, the rheologists were able to achieve a 4% reduction in egg laying, but for the osimum, it was able to do total inhibition. So this is now still on the endpoint of the position. Both extracts were able to reduce the egg laying. Then at 6%, the osimum was more effective than the rheologists, and that total inhibition was achieved between 6 to 12% weight by volume, that is for egg osimum. Now coming to the population reduction, which is now going to be related to the information presented about the egg laying, we found out that these extracts were able to reduce the population by up to 80%. Now, in terms of repellent activity, the two extracts were also strongly repellent to the adult mite. And at the highest concentration that was tested, we were able to get up to 93% repellent, that is for the rheologists, and up to 100% for the osimum. That is basically emphasizing the same information that I've said for the endpoint repellence. But we realize that at lower doses, that is less or equal to 3% weight by volume, Leonardo's extract was more repellent than the osimum. Now, coming to yield and yield components, I'll start with the pods per plant. Both close and season-dependent responses were realized with respect to number of pods per plant. But irrespective of the big botanical plant you applied, more pods were recorded in season one. But across the seasons, pods per plant increased with the dose of extract applied. Now, the information generated from pods per plant directly relates to the response that was finally found in yield, which is expected, is that as you increase the amount of botanical pressure that you apply, you ended up with higher yields. And also, that the botanicals at 3% and above was higher yielding than the synthetic acaricide that was used as the control. Now, in conclusion, the two extracts had a very strong dose-dependent contact toxicity, and the maximum achieved in terms of the kill was 96% kill within 72 hours. We also realized that the dose-dependent and the plant-dependent position inhibition, in this case, would allow us to reach up to 100% inhibition, but with maximum of extract being the more effective extract. Now, botanicals were highly effective with up to about 80% reduction in the population. And then botanicals produced very clear dose and season dependent effect on yield and yield components of the fragile. Now, this work, there's a lot more just to be done so that information that we have can be refined and standardized for purposes of moving to the next level, which is product development and formulations. Now, at that stage, I would want to acknowledge that this work was funded by the forum. I also want to acknowledge that my presence and standing before you here is courtesy of NRA in the UK. I would also want to appreciate in a special way the organizers, led by Brighton, who are their friend. And finally, I want to recognize my employer, Egerton University, who gave me the permission and the opportunity to be here. And last but not least, the audience keen to listen to me. Thank you, ladies and gentlemen. My final message in the thank you slide. At the end of all this, we must be able to put food on the table. Thank you.
Thank you very much. We have answered.
I think what I suggest, what you could do, if you have different doses that you apply, calculate the effect of the EC or ED50 value. In other words, the value that would lead to a 50% effect. That gives much more information than just taking the highest concentration that you have. I think that's a very valuable parameter to use, I think, in most of the studies, if you use different concentrations.
Thank you. That one is going to come because some aspects of the data is still being collected. It's going to come.
Yeah, very nice talk, Joshua. I remember that Angela McKinley this morning mentioned that some of her plants seem to get better yields with the pesticidal plants, and you seem to have shown that even if it's only a slight improvement. Do you have any explanation for why that might be?
Now, the explanation, the target in this case was the two-spotted spider mite, which is a pest of the red. Now, the application that we have, we remember if you have shown the issue of population reduction. It means this aspect of botanical is able to reduce the population on the plant by up to 80%. Therefore, the amount of reduction you expect in terms of yield of the plant is reduced. Therefore, the plant is able to perform. But this is not the only kind of information we have. We have got information which we also witnessed in beans earlier, that is about 10 years ago. But we did not pursue maybe to get it to the actual world or by activity say in the field.
Yeah. So the parasite is effective, the synthetic is effective at killing the mite, and so botanicals give it better yield.
The botanicals also kill. That's why
you can absolutely, but I just wonder, one thing that Angela alluded to is the fact that there might be something else in the botanical extract, that you might get some kind of foliar feeding effect, because there are amino acids and carbohydrates and other things in those extracts. I wonder whether you kind of come to the same conclusion, but it might be an explanation as to why you're getting more yields.
So that could be the next line of thinking in terms of science and see how it works.
Thank you very much, very nice talk. And the decision is made of the fact that there's often a problem with plant identification. How do you know which osmum or cismum you are actually working on?
Fortunately, we normally have a resident taxonomist within the university who is normally part of our scientific team. So we normally have a botanist who helps with the identification in the university.
So the taxonomy alone might not be good enough. Exactly how do you know that this is the osmum or cismum? Because if you go through across India, West Africa, Southern Africa, in South America, you will find Osmo Rajisma. So which one are you actually referring to? Which would be your cheapest way of existing that you've got your standard, which would tell you that you've got other than simply individual?
Now, for the work that we've done normally chemical profiling of the essential oils, and this is not the first time we've worked with the Gratissima, so it's something we know. And we are collecting from known environment.
Yeah?
I'm not getting maybe that bit of the question.
Sorry to request that.
I think it's just important to say, since you know that there are varieties, and I think dimension has already been named that you could chemo varieties. If you would mention what the major component of your oil is, or the essential oil, it would give us an indication of which one you are referring to.
Yeah, for the Gratissima, the major component of the essential oil is the terpenes. And to give you a publication that we did in 08, and has got a profiling of the same.
I think it's very important, that's why I didn't write near that great piece, but you need a voucher specimen to be in a barrier, and technically a voucher specimen that's got some fertile material on it, so you can later come back and see whether it's exactly the same. And I think something that all of us should be in order to do with the plants, you must look at the plant list of Q, because you want not only the genus and the species, you also want to know the taxonomic reference, because that is relatively important. Sometimes there is, you've got an older reference, and names change over time. So I think to everybody, if you, some journals actually expect you to use a plant list to make sure that you've got the taxonomic reference correct as well. But I think it's important to know which plant you hopefully it's still around so you can get a sample. And if you've got a sample that's got some flowers, or seed pods or anything of that type, it's much easier to identify it later.
Okay, for the Osimum, this particular species we have got the live specimen in the more modern organic. So I can go, I cannot put 100% because I'm not a taxonomist, but I can give you with the 95% confidence.
Just a quick comment. You have to, it's always difficult sometimes, but probably ideally you will be able to check with another authority, like you, Botanic Gardens, so you compare your results with another authority, because there they have the largest collection of plants. But we respect what you have done so far to try and ensure the identity.
Then This is in line with the case study of that was done in one of our provinces in Zimbabwe, which is Mashonaland East Province, east of Harare, the main capital city. The research was done with the support of committee to give only a development project which was dubbed the Security and Change in Environment, Organic Conservation Agriculture, which was an initiative involving 1,189 those who are smallholder farmers, 58% of whom were women, and it was undertaken in 2011 to 2015 with the partnership of three organizations, UK-based Garden Africa, from the Rapid Agriculture Centre, and Zimbabwe Organic Producers and Promoters Association, with the primary objective to shift to promote a shift from conventional agriculture between these conventional agriculture to agroecological farming. Through the implementation of this project to the community, we registered the growth in over the years of implementation, the growth in the demand for organic produce in the country and in the region. And this prompted the scaling up of production. And the scaling up of production on agroecology increased the adoption of agroecology and organic production levels, ignited great demand, great need to evaluate the effects of various plant extracts reported to be used by farmers. The farmers will, within their communities, come up with plants that they are using. They will say, they will tell you that they are using these plants and they are working well after they receive some training and knowledge around the issues of agroecology. And then after that, that's when we will start to evaluate, to take samples of these plants and evaluate how these if the claims by the farmers are in compared with our scientific research. And a total of 16 plants as identified plants by the farmers were taken as samples that they were using for controlling the pest. And the samples were collected from the 8 districts of the province where the farmers were claimed to be using the plant material. And the samples were imported based on the location of origin of these plants. And the plant factor that the farmers are claiming to be used in that particular region or in that area of origin. And it was done for all the samples. And I'll try to be quick to run through the 16 samples or the brief of the 16 samples. The first one being asked by Jacob Indica. The results from the analysis, we got three samples from different districts on this one. There was use of ethanol extraction, the plant was being used mainly on the leaf and stem, the mixture of the leaf and stem. And the results from the analysis showed the variation of the chemistry of the samples. And the initial analysis of this of the data suggests that the sample highlighted in green there. The sample highlighted in green, which is sample 21676, collected from Marshall and East from Wetter District, I think. This sample contains a profile of compounds associated with anti-insecticide. The extract was active in tests against those pests. And this compared with farmers' claims on the effectiveness of this botanical extract on storage pests in the community of origin. And also the use of ethanol 100% extraction as a solvent in the leaf and stem also showed the positive results compared to other plants. And this one was the mass spectrum analysis that we got from the results from the sample that we sent to you, with the peaks associated with compounds in the plants that are at 18 minutes, 18 18% happiness, 20.93 and 22.63 as the active sites. And then we also have evidence closer from where we collected about four samples from different districts. And of those four samples, the same highlighted here, we must mostly use as flowers, the plant being used mainly as flowers. Is a solvent, is a sample with the activity, with the highest activity. I'm reporting the highest activity compared to the other samples. But the problem is too high among these samples. That's the analysis that we got. And that's in brief also the analysis from the mass spectrum. We also have Ogunia madagascariensis being among the sample with three samples collected from different districts. And then this one highlighted as leaf and stem being used as the plant parts collected from one of the districts, which is UMP, Usumbamama, Fungwe, locally. It's a sample variety, but in terms of tests, that sample was the most active in the range of horticulture pest control. And the profile of hormones in this exercise differ from other samples. And I think this one came also as a result. We concluded that it was due to the difference in geographical location of origin of these different species. We also have Arica papaya, which we managed to get two samples from different districts, and of those samples, sample 26685 was the most active in terms of pesticide activities. And these are also mainly different in geographical location. But you say, if we are to look at the commercialization of the product, the origins of the sample should be greatly considered in terms of, since it has got a bearing on the efficacy of the final product, if I have to extract the active ingredient in these compounds. These are the analysis. We also look at Gassian. Analysis showed a great variance among the samples, but this samples, none of the samples registered some pesticide activities as to the claim of the farmers. We're not quite sure of the reason why, but farmers claim to be using this mainly for storing grain paste. We also have to look at Arabica that had four samples, and of these four samples, it compared with the farmers' claim to pesticide activities on all the samples. With the samples from a particular district, which is one of the districts being the most highest. And then we also have samples of La Foyana. Those samples were similar in terms of pesticide activities. They didn't show any variation in terms of activities. There was also the tomato, the water tomato that was being mainly used by farmers as the pesticide, the leaf and mainly the leaf as the plant part. This one, the samples represented weak activity in order to the claims of the farmers. Farmers actually claim that is the best of their use. But in terms of the analysis, the results show that it's weak. And then we also have Manuoti, which was also two samples of the leaf being active. We also have Vimeria Sadaki, about five or six samples. Analysis showed difference in chemistry of the leaves and the fruits. But these samples of the leaves were similar, but these similar were also different from those of the fruits. I will have to move and skip some of the specifics. But maybe in conclusion, we can say the practice of organic farming by smallholder farmers is based on general indigenous knowledge with underlying scientific explanation of planting material because being used by smallholder farmers based on indigenous knowledge is a pesticide activities. So, evidence of bio pesticides can be influenced by plant parts used, the origin, the geographical location, and also the correct method of extraction of these plant parts. And if we want to optimize use of plant pesticides by smallholder farmers, it can be decentralized to look at the specific area of origin of that particular plant extract that we are doing. And more analysis have to be conducted in terms of determining the effective application of each plant pesticide. I thank you.
Thank you very much for interesting talk, and we have time for questions.
Well, as it's a geographical difference, do you think it's due to the nature of the soil where the plant's grown, or is it genetically different? So if you took seeds from that plant and grew it in a different location, it would give the same profile as from the original place?
I think from a simple analysis, it's a combination of a lot of factors that comes into play. Because there was an instance where farmers would take samples or they would take planting material from one location and plant it in their locality, but it also brought different results from where it originated from. So a combination of factors. We cannot really point out that this one is genetic or environmental. They work both in combination.
Thank you for your presentation. Like mass spectrometrics, I'm wondering how did you decide that the your plants are different or similar? Do you use any statistic analysis for saying that?
In response, probably for all known that one, I'm not in the very best person to answer. But we sent these samples to the Royal Botanical Gardens Q, where we analyzed and we were sending back the results from Professor Monique Simpson. She's the one who gave us the detailed analysis.
Okay, thank you for the wonderful presentation. My concern is on the mention of geographical location, we are probably also considering the age of the plants that are being used. Was that taken into account, or it was just plants that were harvested and then you went on to test? Secondly, on your conclusions, you mentioned the issue of geographical location, the patch used. I'm not so sure whether you did do a whole phytochemical analysis in terms of comparing, should it be the roots or leaves or the twigs or the whole rather, in terms of the chemistry of the plant, then to come to a conclusion to say parts used can then make some differences. And then thirdly, you mentioned in terms of correct method of extraction. I wonder whether we can come to a conclusion of rearranging at a correct method of extraction. Literature probably that we have showing us diverse methods and even different results with different solvents used and so forth. Can we really come to a conclusion of saying this is the method of extraction?
Can I comment about the method of extraction, actually? The problem is that all these compounds have different polarities and different properties, so no one single method of extraction is going to be ideal for all the different chemicals that are being used, because the whole range of plant materials that you use have very different biologically active chemicals, so that's a problem. What we might be able to do is think about a generic method at small scale. And I'll talk a little bit about that tomorrow morning, but it revolves largely around some of the ideas that Professor Eisen was talking about with respect to using soaps and hot water. That might be the way forward. So.
Your presentation, actually, on the geographical location, I think there the
despite some good evidence that there is some variation.
However,
it would be very interesting to try and support the geographical areas with probably the environmental data in terms of temperature, in terms of rainfall. So maybe we could start thinking about linking those things. And maybe soil type. So we can try and see if there are some similarities in certain areas which have got same soil or which have got very high temperatures. Are we seeing some particular trend there? I think so. Mine is like a comment already. Thank you.
Okay.
That's a very good presentation. It's a very interesting presentation. My comment, this is where it comes, you don't need to answer them. Were these wild? Were these plants taken from the wild or were they cultivated? Were they taken at the same time of the year or were they taken at different times of the year? Were they taken at different soil types and so on? These are the underlying factors that one must have in order to be able to interpret those results. But otherwise, the work is minimal.
That there is also need to look at the variety, because you may have the same species, but that species contains different variety.
And you have either the one you have, but with the one you have, you will have different varieties. Tomorrow I have a presentation and I'll show that. Thank you.
Thank you so much for the comments. Probably to respond to questions that came from the comments. In terms of the age of the plant, we didn't really look much into the age. We being the age like farmers, so because we didn't explore much of that. It's an area that needs to be analyzed. And also in terms of the environmental factors, analysis of the environmental factors, I think it's a point that we need to consider looking at measuring or coming up with a change of how things move, this will influence the in terms of property. And then in terms of the term of the yield, I think it's also an area that we need to explore in terms of determining the actual efficacy of these plants, the best time of efficacy. It's an area that we need to explore. Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Next speaker.
Thank you.
Next speaker,
thank you.
Next speaker is Maurice. We're going to talk about the effect of new oil produced locally on the control of two major cousin pests in Menes, the Rigoberta barnifera and Aphis rosicorum.
Good afternoon, everybody. I'm Mori Elekwede. I come from Benin, West Africa. The research I want to present today is of the effects of neem oil produced locally on the control of two major cotton pests in the neem. Helicobacter pangea and Aphis rosicorum. I go through the presentation. Cotton have a very important in the neem economy and for social. In the social and working part, we can say that a lot of farmers depend on the income provided of the cotton commercialization. For the state, on the economic part, the income, cotton was the major part of exportation, around 18%, and contribute to basic agro-industry for 16%. In 2009, it contributes to 13% of the gross domestic production. But this result was less than what we expected, because despite what we introduce in this production, we don't have a good economical result. In fact, the cotton productivity activity is influenced by several factors on which we have insect tests. More than 500 insects are reported in total in sub-Saharan Africa, in Benin, a dozen of cake tests, including a chosen paradigma and Aphis docipi, have been identified. Without treatment in Benin, insect pests may be responsible of loss up to 58% of the yield. To manage these pests, farmers generally use chemical pesticides. The consumption of pesticides was in permanent increase, and then from 1993 to 2000, we observed an increase of 17%. For 2010, the increase of chemical pesticides for around 6%. But this use don't give us the effective results and have a consequence on environment and health. That leads also leads to pest resistance in some insects like Helicobacter pyogenes, and that is toxic to other non-target organisms. Because of this negative effect and limited success of this chemical, we decided to review other strategies to control pests in Benin. The objective of this research was the evaluation of effectiveness of green oil produced locally for cotton pest management. Specifically, we assessed green oil effectiveness in situ for the management of this pest and evaluated the impact of green oil on the biology of Aphis docipi and Helicobacter pyogenes. Our material was to have the common active framework of Helicobacter pyogenes, we have a species of the damage, and we have an Aphis docipi. In this stage, we have two new oil products to use in the research. To see the specific effectiveness effect of new oil on Helicobacter, the itself experience consists of a dose response itself. Three groups of 10 first stage larvae reduced fasting for 24 hours exposed to three treatments of three types of treatment. Testing those we have 5 groups of green oil, 5 groups of opio, and for the control, this year was the monitoring of the to see the effect of immune of Helicobacter biology. We put some first data on for 3 hours, a 24 hours of openly tested by the precedent project. Then after 24 hours, now we were transferred from 20 cotton leaves. We assessed the of larvae affected through estimation of leaf iron consumption. For Aphis docipi, the same work was done. Docipi larvae were expected to free treatment. For the impact of NIM on the development of Aphis docipi, we still need the fertility. Statistical analysis. Both response was analyzed with the profit analysis method using the data of the mortality of the two pests, lean iron consumed by any program parameter and fertility of the were compared by performance analysis. The symptom we are obtained was this.
on the effect of names, on the equivocal parameter, mortality, we see that for each level of produce use, you have a mortality statistical higher than the control. Then we can say that names are comparable to the control of clinical member amygdala. But we saw that for the same dose of opium and Nepal, we have a high mortality, a better high mortality for Nepal than opium. Then we can say that opium Nepal's was have more effect than opium. For the bottom consumption, we see that we don't have all those used for the test because some of the larvae don't survive. Then for what we have that survival, we saw that the control consumption of leaf was higher than all the test. And that for the limit of 5%, we have a result statistical identity with the top U level. To a dose response analysis with a cost regression, we saw that we determined we have a temporal dose response dependence. And we can see that top U cannot eliminated 55% of the helicopter population in 1 day or 2 days. And when we compare Nepal and Tokyo, we see that in 18 days, we see that we have much less dose of Nepal than Tokyo to control the same part of the population. For AFIS OCP results, we can see the same effect according to the two results, but we saw that the top pure level of 3.2 have a statistical result identical to the control. And we can say that Lincoln had a better result than top pure. To the fertility effect in the biology development of the insect, we saw that control had a better result than the test. To the both dependence, we saw that we can reduce some for these insects, we can reduce the fertility around 19% with opium. And